Okay, Assalamualaikum and good evening. I think I will start the class now. Can you hear my voice?
Waalaikumsalam, saya boleh saya.
Alright. Right, can you see my slide?
Yes, sir.
All right, good. Okay, so today we will continue with our lecture 8. Okay, still on the calculation part. Okay, so today we are going to cover on the topic of economic assessment. So on this topic, I will divide it into two parts of lecture. Okay, lecture 8 and lecture 9, which I will cover tomorrow lah. Okay, so because I believe if I cover all related to economic assessment today, I think it's too much for you. Okay, so I will give a little bit today and tomorrow we are going to finish on this topic of economic assessment. Okay. So before we continue, let's recap what we have learned, last week. Before the midterm break, okay, in regarding our lecture 7. In the topic of time value of money lah, alright. So basically, we have learned on how we can forecast the future in terms of making an investment, making a planning for our company's investment, or perhaps the knowledge that you learned before the midterm break could be used for your personal life as well. Alright. So today we are going to learn more on how we can assess the economic level in terms of company's future investment, okay, in the project, okay, what are the areas or what are the best option that the companies could make financially, right, in order to make a lot of profit from their investment lah. Right, so this is the outline for today's lecture. Okay, so we are going to have an introduction, of course, as usual. Okay, we are going to have a look on what is capital expenditure and what is capital budgeting. Okay, yang nak join. Okay, we are going to have a look what is capital expenditure and what is capital budgeting. And then we are going to learn on appraisal techniques. Okay, appraisal techniques in general before we go into detail. Yep, I'm going to be join. Okay, appraisal technique before we go into detail in general is about the method of evaluation of option that we have. Okay, perhaps we have a lot of options in our business, in our, or maybe in terms of project, we have three options. Okay, whether we want to go for project A, project B, or project C. So perhaps by using this appraisal techniques, we can evaluate which is the best option for our company to go for. Okay, maybe project A is more profitable compared to project B and C. So we are going to use what we call it as appraisal techniques in order to evaluate the option that we have lah. So in order to use these appraisal techniques, we have five techniques, okay, which are: the first one is net present value, and then internal rate of return, and then we have modified internal rate of return, MIRR, and then we have payback period and also accounting rate of return. Okay, for today, I only cover three, okay, which are NPV, IRR, and also MIRR. Okay, saya tak nak bagi semua inilah, nanti too much for you. So tomorrow kita akan sambung another two. Alright. Alright, for introduction, how we can assess the option that we have is also known as an investment appraisal techniques lah, as I mentioned earlier. Alright, it also can be defined as an assessment tools to make decision whether and investment project is worthwhile, or where alternative exists, which option is likely to be the best. Okay, so maybe we don't have option, we have only one option that we have. So from there, we also can use investment appraisal technique to see the benefits of going for that project lah. Okay, or in other cases, we have alternative. Means that, as like I mentioned earlier, we have options. Okay, we have option, a few options, B, project A, B, or C. So we can assess using appraisal technique, and we can use this appraisal technique to evaluate which alternative or which option is the best for our company. Okay, that's what we call it as an investment appraisal techniques. So any investment decision involve risk. Of course, when we make decision, any decision that we make, there will be a risk on it. Okay, why there is a risk? Because it we deal with the future. Okay, for example, like we are going to go for a project that have a duration about 4 years, 5 years. Okay, anything can happen within that period, within that four or five years. Okay, so therefore it is vital to assess the number alternative so that we could choose the best option. Okay, so that's why it is imperative, or it is vital, or it is important for us to use this technique in order to make sure that we are not going to regret the decision that we made. Okay, so in assessing the alternative, there are two experts that are very critical, which are capital expenditure and also capital budgeting. So what are they? We are going to have a look on the next slide. So firstly, we have a look on the capital expenditure. Okay, what is capital expenditure? So basically, capital expenditure are the amounts spent for tangible assets that will be used for more than 1 year in the operations of a business. Okay, capital expenditure is the money that we spend to buy asset, long-term asset. Okay, that we need to pay for a long period, means that for more than a year lah. Okay, we have later on when we move on to lecture 10, 11, nanti we are going to learn more about asset ni lah. Okay, we have short term, long term and so on. So while capital expenditure is more on long term punya investment, alright. So capital expenditure can be thought as the amount spent to acquire, improve a company's fixed asset. Okay, company punya asset. So for example like the purchase of machinery, equipment, furniture, building improvements, computer information system and leasehold improvements. Alright, so that's an example of fixed asset that we have in business lah. Alright, basically there are three important aspects of capital expenditure, which are, the first one is long-term effects. Of course, capital expenditure is more on long-term investment. Of course, there will be a long-term effects to our business or to our organization. Alright, the second aspect of capital expenditure is about irreversibility. Means that once you have decided you want to buy that asset, it cannot be reversible. Okay, you tak boleh nak change the decision. Okay, once you go for it, you have to commit to it lah. Alright, and the last aspect of capital expenditure is substantial capital outlays. Alright, means that they will give an impact to your financial statement in your companies lah. Okay, so you have a long term commitment that you need to obey in order to go for that fixed asset, okay, long term asset. Alright, next, the thing that we need to know is more important than capital expenditure when we want to make that, what we call it as an appraisal technique, is about capital budgeting. Right, capital budgeting is a systematic approach to determine whether a company's planned major capital investment are worth pursuing. Okay, so in making the decision in terms of capital budgeting, we want to allocate our capital budgeting. So we need some systematic approach. Okay, whereby we're going to investigate or evaluate the investment that we are going to make is worth to go. it worth it to go. Alright, so that's come into the idea of what we call it as implementing the appraisal technique tadi. Often a company assesses a prospective project's lifetime cash flow inflows and outflows to determine whether the potential returns generated meet a sufficient target benchmark, also known as investment appraisals. Okay, so we are going to investigate the cash inflow and outflow of that particular project, whether it is sufficient enough for us to go for it. Okay, adakah ada berbaloi untuk kita teruskan atau tidak? Okay, so adakah berbaloi atau tidak untuk teruskan dengan investment on that particular project? Okay, so basically managing the capital budgeting, there are two questions that need to be answered. Okay, the first one is which proposed project will most increase the company's value over time? And the second question, are any of the proposed projects profitable enough? Okay, so we need to pick or choose the best option that we have that give more profitable to the organization lah, and as well as the company's values over time lah, whether it is will enhance or establish our company's image when we go for that project. Alright, so this is the phases of capital budgeting or the process involved. Okay, so of course we are going to start with the planning, and then planning means that we are going to have a look on what option that we have. Okay, which tender we want to go through. Okay, maybe kita ada few option, ada 4 or 5 options, and then we'll analyze which one is the best for us to go. And then in order to the next phases or the next process is selection. Kat sinilah datangnya konsep ataupun evaluation process yang kita panggil tadi appraisal techniques. Okay, so here we are going to select based on the shortlisted project yang kita dah list tadi. Maybe for at the beginning during the planning stage kita ada banyak option, ada 5, ada okay, we have a lot of option. Selepas we scrutinize, kita tengok maybe kita shortlisted to maybe 3 or 4 only. So from there kita akan gunakan selection process by implementing what we call it as the appraisal technique tadi. Okay, so after we have applied this appraisal technique, barulah kita select dan kita implement dan kita review lah, okay, whether whatever we assess or evaluate before, whether it is being follow ataupun lari daripada apa yang kita target lah. Alright, so the application of appraisal techniques are very useful in the context of construction industry. Okay, these techniques are very helpful and very useful in our context of construction industry, whereby we can implement this technique on the economic comparison between different items of plan or method. Okay, maybe we have option to go for a robotic punya process plan. Okay, gunakan teknologi mesin yang lebih up to date ataupun kita gunakan mesin sedia ada. Okay, in terms of construction method, okay, kita ada option sama ada kita nak guna traditional method or we want to go for IBS for example. Okay, so kita boleh calculate which option is the best for us, whether we go for IBS or whether we go for traditional method. Okay, another application of appraisal technique in context of construction industry is on the recovery of capital invested in plan through either internal or external hiring. Okay, so maybe you are manufacturing company, okay, producing IBS for example. Okay, you are company that produce IBS. Okay, so you want to invest more on production on IBS. Okay, so perhaps you need to buy a new plant, okay, a new machine. Okay, sama ada you beli sendiri, which means you doing it internally, or you appoint another third party. Okay, so you hire third party to use the plan. So something goes to a certain project, maybe there is a project that need require for you to use tunnel. Tunnel punya machine to dig the tunnel. Okay, so sama ada you beli sendiri the machine or you hire from third party. Okay, which is the best option for you. Okay, so you can use this appraisal technique as well. Okay, assessing the replacement age of plant items. Okay, so maybe you have, for example, like you have backhoe, katakan. You dah lama dah ada 10 tahun backhoe tu. Okay, so dia punya capability nak guna pun makin lama makin kurang sebab dah berusia. So, you can assess sama ada whether you want to maintain it atau you want to buy a new one. Okay, mana yang lebih menguntungkan bagi syarikat you. Okay, also you can use this appraisal technique. Okay, decision relating to utilization. Okay, utilize in terms of plan, in terms of human labor and so on. The effect of corporation tax and development grants on the economics of plant ownership. Okay, so in terms of, as I give example just now, whether is it worth it for you to buy the plant ataupun you nak sewa teknologi luar, guna teknologi luar yang maybe some of, perhaps you need to pay a tax for that sebab you import daripada luar dan sebagainya. So you also can apply this appraisal techniques lah. Okay, in order to investigate which option is the best for you. Okay. Alright. So that's a brief introduction on appraisal technique. Okay. So the most important part is you need to know about the capital budgeting lah. Okay, the process. Okay, and how you're going to select the best option that you have that could give more profitable to your organization or to your companies. Alright, so basically what is appraisal techniques? Okay, appraisal technique is an investment decision implies the existence of an objective lah. So it's an investment decision. Okay, means that when you apply this technique, it will help you to make the right decision. Okay, I cannot say it's going to be 100% accurate, but at least you have a justification on why you go for that option or why you go for that project, for example. Okay, the purpose of the financial evaluation is to rank each project in terms of its financial desirability. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier lah, kalau you ada tiga pilihan, dia boleh bagi rank. Project mana yang you need to give a priority? Okay, project A ke B ke C ke. Maybe by using this appraisal technique, the result show that project C is more profitable. Okay, so they can rank your option. Right, there are two techniques in comparing the expected return on the investment project. Okay, kalau tadi at the beginning of the slide tadi saya tunjuk ada lima method atau lima techniques. Okay, tapi dalam lima techniques ni atau lima method of calculation yang kita ada ni sebenarnya dia ada terbagi kepada dua teknik yang besar. Okay, which are aku boleh pakai ni. Okay, kita ada dua teknik yang besar, which is discounting method of evaluation and also traditional method of evaluation. Okay, so under under discounting method of evaluation, kita ada ni, tiga ni. Net present value, internal rate of return, modified internal rate of return, MIRR. Okay, this is what we're going to cover today. Okay, another techniques which is known as traditional method of construction. We have two techniques ataupun method yang kita boleh apply, which are payback period and also accounting rate of return, ARR. Okay, so this one we are going to cover tomorrow. Okay. So, before we go into detail on each method, okay, especially today kita akan pergi tiga tadi, NPV, IRR and MIRR. So, before that, we have a look on the selection rules. Okay, bila kita apply calculation, kita nak tahu mana pilihan kita terbaik based on NPV, based on IRR, based on MIRR dan sebagainya. Okay, so this is, I can say, is a kitab for you for this technique. Okay, you kena ingat this five rules, the selection rules. Okay, so have a look on this first one, NPV, net present value. When you apply this NPV, the calculation, when you apply the calculation of NPV, you get result more than more than zero means that you can accept that project. Tapi kalau NPV value for that project is less than zero, okay, you can reject that project. Okay, so that's how you select. Okay, based on this selection rule. Okay, kita yang you kena ingat. Okay, indifferent dia, maksud dia NPV you dapat kosong. So means that you go for it pun boleh, tak pilih pun boleh. Okay, you in the middle, tak kisah. You boleh pilih, is worth it to go, worth it also to reject. Okay, it's up to you. Okay, kalau you dapat result NPV kosong. Okay, so that's what we call it as NPV. Ini dia punya selection rule untuk NPV inilah. Okay, untuk second method yang kita boleh apply, which is IRR, internal rate of return. Okay, so here kalau you dapat IRR lebih daripada cost of capital, you boleh accept. Kalau kurang daripada cost of capital, you kena reject. Okay, kalau sama, again sama. Pergi pilih boleh, tak pilih pun boleh. Alright, itu untuk IRR. Okay, untuk MIRR, okay, sama juga macam IRR tadi. Okay, kalau lebih daripada cost of capital, you need to accept. Less than cost of capital, you need to reject. Okay, kalau sama, again, it's the same. You boleh pilih atau tak. Okay, up to you. Okay, and then method number 4 is payback period. PBP. Okay, if you got less than target period, you need to accept. Kalau more than target period, you have to reject. You have that option. Okay, kalau yang sama dengan ni, again sama. Alright, and the last one is ARR, accounting rate of return. Okay, kalau lebih daripada target rate, you are going to accept it. Kalau less than target rate, you have to reject it. Okay, kalau sama, samalah konsep dia tadi. Okay, so this is the rules that you have to remember lah. Okay, you kena ingat lima benda ni. Okay, kita ada lima method yang kita boleh apply when we assessing a project. Okay, but it is not necessary to apply all. Okay, tak semestinya kena apply lima-lima ni bila kita ada option, kita ada, katakan kita ada dua pilihan projek, projek A atau B. Okay, but it is advisable for you to apply as many as you can. Okay, dua ke tiga ke, kalau nak apply semua pun boleh, up to you. Tapi kalau satu, is not advisable sebab satu tu dia punya justification tak kuat. Okay, sebab kadang-kadang bila kita guna NPV, dia kata projek A bagus. Tapi bila kita apply IRR, dia kata projek B bagus. That's why you kena apply as many method as you can, so that you boleh nampak yang mana yang terbaik untuk you pilih, project A atau B tadi. Okay, so that's why we have a lot of method here. Okay, okay, firstly kita tengok on discounting methods of evaluation technique, which consists of three tadi, NPV, IRR and also MIRR. Okay, firstly kita tengok on what we call it as NPV, net IRR and also MIRR. Okay, firstly kita tengok on what we call it as NPV, okay, net present value. Alright, why is net present value? The basis of NPV method is that all future payment received are converted to present value. Okay, NPV can be used as a means of determining whether a project is profitable enough to be considered as a worthwhile investment. So project with the highest NPV is the most favorable to invest. Okay, kalau you ada tiga project tadi, you apply this NPV, yang mana paling tinggi, yang itulah you pilih. Okay, itu based on concept of NPV. Okay, nanti kita akan tengok macam mana nak calculate. I am going to show you the example later on. Okay, so while internal rate of return is a project, the IRR of a project is the discount rate which makes NPV equal to zero. Okay, so kalau you baca teori ni quite confusing sikit lah, but later on bila kita apply the calculation prep, you get a better view. Okay, the purpose is to differentiate between two or more project in order to choose the least expensive project. Okay, the least expensive means that yang bagi in terms of interest dia yang rendah dan sebagainya. Okay, the IRR sometimes is called as discounted cash flow yield, DCF yield. Okay, DCF yield is the maximum interest rate that could be paid on borrowed capital lah. Okay, and never mind, nanti kita akan go through lah. And as I mentioned just now, when you it is advisable for you to apply as many method as you can. Okay, tadi kita ada 5 method, kalau boleh apply banyak, 2, 3 dan sebagainya. Okay, when you, for example lah, like your company decided you want to use NPV dengan IRR sahaja. Okay, you nak guna 2 method sahaja, NPV dengan IRR. But, bila you, let's say company you ada pilihan project A and project B. Okay, you ada 2 pilihan project A and project B. Okay. Kita berhenti kejap sebab tengah azan. Okay, sambung eh. Okay, repeat again. Okay, let's say your company have two options, project A and project B, and your company decided they want to use two methods only, NPV and IRR. Okay, so let's say when you your company apply using NPV, the results show that your company should go for project A. But when they apply using the method of IRR, the result show that your company should go for project B. Okay, so kat situ kita boleh tengok ada conflicts. Alright, so when there is a conflict between your option, you can apply what we call it as an incremental analysis. Okay, so basically this incremental analysis is used to analyze the difference between the two projects. Okay, kalau ada conflict, ada perbezaan. Okay, NPV kata project A, IRR kata project B. Okay, kalau ada konflik, ada perbezaan, kita boleh apply what we call it as incremental analysis. Alright, so incremental analysis is a decision making technique used in business to determine the true cost difference between alternative. Okay, I can say that when you apply this incremental analysis, the result will be more accurate. Okay, so basically this analysis will help the decision makers to overcome the conflicts between multiple discounted method of evaluation when comparing multiple project or option. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier. So how can incremental analysis overcome this conflict? So can overcome it by using a formula, or you can overcome it by using a graph paper, which using the graph paper or by all, even though you are using the formula, you need to find what we call it as a Fisher intersection, as shown in this slide. Okay, Fisher intersection. Okay, it taken the name of economics known as Irving Fisher. Okay, so this intersection means that you need to determine the slopes of the cash flow profile. Okay, kita akan cari titik pertemuan antara dua option yang kita ada. So from there kita boleh buat decision yang lebih tepat. Okay, so I'm going to show to you later on. Don't worry. Okay, let's have a look on the example. Okay, kita tengok dulu macam mana nak apply NPV and IRR. Okay, so here the example. ABC Sdn Bhd is a block work manufacturer in Klang Valley. Okay, an initial outlay of RM9,000 has been allocated by the top management to utilize some spare manufacturing capacity of the company. The top management, the dah allocate RM9,000. Okay, so the company has two options based on RM9,000 ni, apa yang dia nak buat. Sama ada they can manufacture new product or they can manufacture more of the existing product by using this RM9,000. Okay, you ada pilihan sekarang. Sama ada you nak buat produk baru ataupun you go for more of the existing product. Produk sedia ada ni you tambah lagi. Produce more. Okay, dengan menggunakan modal RM9,000 yang diberikan oleh top management. Okay, itu dia punya scenario. Okay. It is assumed that neither product will generate any income after 4 years. Okay, kita assume while whether you go for new product ataupun you produce more on the existing product, you tak akan dapat any income, any profit selepas 4 tahun. Okay, you kena tunggu 4 tahun baru you boleh generate income. So ABC Sdn Bhd calculates the minimum acceptable rate of return at 12%. Okay, ini rate return dia minimum adalah 12%. So calculate the NPV, IRR and determine the intersection point for both product. Okay, so this is the estimated cash flow for each product. Okay, dengan RM9,000 tadi, tahun pertama you akan dapat pulangan RM480. Kalau you pergi new product, existing product you akan dapat RM5,800. Alright, tahun kedua you akan dapat RM3,700, yang ini RM3,250 and so on lah, seterusnya based on this table. Okay, so we are going to use this on applying on how you can calculate how we can evaluate the option that we have, whether we go for new product or existing product by using two method only, NPV and IRR. Okay, first kita tengok macam mana nak calculate NPV, net present value. Okay. Okay, kolom belah kiri saya ni adalah net new product. A, saya bagi nama A, and yellow kolom ni adalah existing product B. Okay, so ni dia punya cash flow yang been given based on previous table tadi. Okay, year zero ni adalah permulaan, adalah modal yang diberikan adalah sebanyak RM9,000. Okay, ni pun RM9,000 untuk produk B ataupun existing product. Okay, ni cash flow tadi daripada table RM480, RM3,700, RM9,550, RM3,780. Ini semua ambil daripada table tadi. Sama juga dengan existing product RM5,800, RM3,250, RM2,000, RM1,561. Semua ambil daripada previous table tadi. Okay, so firstly you need to total up the first column ni. Kolom yang pertama ni you kena total up kan. Okay, ni negatif. Alright, dalam kurungan ni maksudnya negatif. Kenapa negatif? Sebab ini duit company keluar. Okay, duit modal yang company generate, yang allocate to your management, to your department. Okay, company bagi RM9,000, ini kira modal kita. So maksudnya dia negatif, duit yang kita keluar. Okay, so negatif. Total up maksudnya negatif RM9,000 tambah RM480. Tambah RM3,700, RM3,750, RM6,550, RM3,780. Jadi akan dapat total RM5,550. Okay, so sama juga kat sini, you kena total up kan. Negatif RM9,000 tambah RM5,800, seterusnya you dapat RM3,611. Okay, So after that, based on the question tadi, dia bagi minimum acceptable rate of return dia adalah 12%. Baik. Ada yang boleh join? Sekejap. Okay. Gantung based on the question tadi, minimum rate of return dia adalah, minimum acceptable rate of return dia adalah 12%. Okay. 12%. Kolom yang kedua ni, you kena masukkan value of 12% ni tadi. Okay. 1089379712 0.636. Okay. Daripada mana dapat this value? You dalam dalam you future saya ada masukkan table ni. Ada? Anyone seorang? Kita tak download lagi.
Ada, sir.
Okay, so you need to refer to this table. Okay, you need to refer to this table. Okay, so based on questions, dia bagi 12%. So ini tahun. Ini value percentage dia. Okay, ini tahun. 1 sampai tahun 50 kalau soalan sampai 50. Tapi soalan kita sampai tahun keempat saja. So you ambil 0.893, 0.797, 792, 636. Okay, so ambil daripada table ni, masukkan dalam table kat sini. Okay, clear? Boleh? Sebab sini 12%.
Yes,
okay, so you refer to the table. Boleh. Dapatkan figure dia, tengok tahun 1 sampai 4, ambil masukkan dalam ni. Okay, so dapat di situ. Sama juga dekat yang untuk existing product ni pun. Okay, you ambil value yang sama. Okay, daripada table yang sama, masukkan dalam table ni. Next process yang you buat adalah kolom 1 ni, ni saya dah namakan kolom ni 1, 2. Okay, so 1 ni kalikan dengan 2. Okay, maksudnya negatif 9000 kali 1, 480 kali 0.893, 3700 kali 0.797, 6550 kali 0.712, 3780 kali 0.636. Then you akan dapat lah jawapan dekat what we call it as a PW factor. Kolom yang seterusnya. Okay, you akan dapat jawapan ni. Alright. So bila you dapat jawapan kat sini, again, konsep yang sama mula-mula tadi you buat, you kena total up kolom yang ni. Kolom yang ni you kena total up. Maksudnya negatif negatif 9000 tambah 429, tambah 2949, tambah 4664, tambah 2404. So you akan dapat 1445 total dia. Okay, itu untuk new product A. Okay, untuk product B, existing product, repeat the same process. Saya dah namakan kolom 4, kolom 5. Okay, so you kena kalikan kolom 4 dengan 5 ni. Okay, sama proses dia. Macam tadi. Okay, negatif 900 kali 1, 5800 kali 0.893. So you akan dapatlah jawapan di kolom PW kat sini. Okay, after that, repeat the same process, negatif 9000 tambah 5179, tambah 2590, tambah 1424, tambah 993. So you akan dapat jawapan 1186. Okay, so based on this answer, yang mana you akan pilih? New product ke existing product? Anyone?
New product.
Okay, so new product. You kena pilih yang lagi tinggi. So dalam case NPV ni, kita akan go for new product sebab jawapan dia 1445. Lebih tinggi daripada existing product, which is 1185. Okay? So of course kat sini dua-dua positif lah. Okay? Tapi dalam konteks ni sebab dia lebih besar. Okay, so we go for product A. Right, itu NPV. Okay, So next, kalau you based on this results, perhaps your decision will not be strong enough sebab you only based on one method saja. So nak dapatkan justification yang lebih kuat, you apply pula IRR. Okay, IRR. Jadi nak apply IRR. Okay. Yang ini tadi kita dah kira. Betul? Tengok tadi sama semua kan? Okay, based on 12% punya minimum acceptable rate of return. Okay, ini tadi kita kira. Alright, nampak tak? Sama kan? Anyone?
Sama.
Okay, sama. So what you need to do next adalah, okay, IRR ni dia ada konsep try and error. Okay, so table. Table ni tadi, okay, so tadi diberi 12%. Okay, so sekarang ni you kena pilih daripada 14 sampailah ke 40 ni, you kena try and error sampailah you dapat yang ini negatif. Okay, let's say you pakai let's say you nak try dengan 16 dulu katakan. Okay, 16 ni okay, 0.862, 0.743, 0.841, 0.552. Okay, you pun masuk dalam ni. Okay, proses dia sama kan? Proses 3 dia tadi macam saya tunjuk NPV tadi, sama. Okay, 1 kali 2, okay, kolom ni kali kolom ni, sama. Okay, you try pakai 16 dulu tadi. You pakai 16 tapi masih positif. Okay, you kena try balik, pilih lain pula. You try pula 20. Okay, you try 20, new product negatif, existing product masih positif. Tak boleh juga, dia kena dua-dua negatif. Try lain pula. So you try lah 22% ni. Okay, try 22% ni, masukkan dalam table. Okay, masukkan dalam table. Okay, try masukkan dalam table. Kita ambil daripada table tadi 22% ni value daripada table 0.82, 672, 521, 0.451. Alright, so you calculate, apply the same concept yang saya tunjuk, like I show you just now on how to apply the calculation of NPV. Okay, ni kali ni harap, okay, you dapat ni, then you total up this column, tambahkan dia, you akan dapat negatif 806. Okay, so untuk existing product pun sama, you apply, you dapat negatif 2.54. Okay, so bila dapat dua-dua negatif, baru you boleh proceed to the next step, which is applying this formula. Okay, IR equals to RA tambah PWA tolak RB tolak RA divide by PWA tolak PWB. Okay, nampak macam complicated, sabar, jangan risau. Okay, ini dia punya RA, lower discount rate. Maksudnya discount rate dia sekarang yang paling rendah adalah 12. Okay, RB, higher discount rate adalah sekarang 22. Okay, PWA is NPV using the lower discount rate. Okay, maksudnya PWA ni NPV dia yang ini. Okay, and PWB, NPV using the higher discount rate, which is yang ni, negatif ni tadi. Okay, you apply. Okay, alright, RA lower discount rate, which is 12%. Okay, you ambil 12% ni. PWA is NPV using the lower discount rate, 1.445. Okay, 1.445. Okay, RB tolak RA, so 22% tolak 12. Maksudnya higher tolak lower, 22 tolak 12. Okay, divide by NPV using higher rate tadi, 1.445, tolak tambah negatif 806. Okay, so yang ini you pilih highest juga. Okay, yang ini sekarang kita calculation ni kita pilih yang highest untuk jawapan MPV lah. Yang ini kita pilih 145, yang ini kita pilih negatif 1086. Negatif 806. Okay, so you apply this formula, you akan dapat 18.4%. Okay, ini untuk A. Kita kira A dulu. Alright, and then kita calculate IRR untuk B. Okay, 12% sama. So IRR untuk B adalah 1186. Okay, IRR untuk B using 22% adalah 2-254. Okay, -254. So you akan dapat 20.2%. Okay, dalam kes ni bila you apply IRR, you tengok yang tinggi adalah IRR B. Maksudnya existing product lagi tinggi daripada new product. So kat sini dah ada konflik. Because bila kita apply method NPV tadi, result show that you should go for new product. But when you apply for IRR, you should go for existing product. Okay, so dia ada perbezaan kat situ, ada konflik. So when there is a conflict, kita akan apply what we call it as incremental analysis. So far okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay, I know it's quite challenging because calculation kan untuk you nampak macam ni is quite different. But I try my best to give you an idea on how to apply this method. Later on nanti bila kita habis kelima method sampai esok, nanti ada exercise, you try buat dulu and next week kita akan bincang bersama-sama lah. Okay. So hopefully you can get the idea lah macam mana nak apply all this method. Okay, next kita tengok on how we can use this what we call it as incremental analysis. Okay, remember tadi bila kita nak apply incremental analysis when there is a conflict between NPV and also IRR. Okay, dalam contoh kita sekarang, of course there is a conflict because NPV suggest us for us to go for a new product, while IRR suggest us to go for a existing product. So ada conflict. So nak solve the conflict, kita gunakan incremental analysis. As I mentioned just now, ada dua cara nak selesaikan ataupun nak implement incremental analysis. Ada first cara guna graph paper. Second method, we are using formula. Okay, firstly, I'm going to show you how to use incremental analysis using graph paper. Okay, of course, when you want to use graph paper, you need information for you to plot in your graph paper. Okay, what are the required information as shown in this table? Okay, dalam table ni. Okay, yellow one is new product and the grey one is existing product. Okay, nak plot graph paper, you kena tahu x-axis is for interest. Okay, sorry. Yes. X. Graph paper ada X dengan Y kan? X-axis dengan Y-axis. Okay. Interest is for X-axis yang garis ni. NPV ni is for Y. Okay. Yang ke bawah. Okay. For you to plot lah. Okay. So firstly, when interest zero, okay, NPV is 5510. Remember mula-mula tadi. Okay, remember tadi saya suruh calculate total ni. Bila NPV kita kosong, bila interest kita kosong, NPV kita adalah 5510. Okay, so bila NPV kita, so bila interest kita 12, NPV kita adalah 1445. Okay, itu maksudnya. So sekarang ni interest kosong, NPV kita adalah 5510. Okay, ini yang saya suruh tambah mula-mula tadi. Okay, so bila interest 12%, kita kira tadi kita dapat 1445. Okay, so bila kita apply IRR, kita dapat 18.40. NPV kita akan kosong. Okay, itu dia punya rule of thumb. Sebab bila kita apply IRR, it will make our NPV equals to zero. Itu konsep IRR. Okay, bila kita apply IRR, NPV kita equals to zero. Okay. So bila kita apply 22% tadi, kita dapat NPV kita negatif 806. Ni semua kita dah calculate tadi. Alright. So untuk existing product pun sama. Alright. Interest 0, NPV kita 3611. 12% tadi kita dah calculate 1186. IRR tadi kita calculate 20.2% NPV kita kosong. Alright, when we apply interest 22%, we got negative 254. Alright, so based on this data, you plot in the graph paper. Okay, say of course kita tak, saya tak ada graph paper lah, saya gunakan gambar je. Okay, so the blue line is the new product, okay, product A, blue line. Okay, red line is the existing product. Okay, so you plot 0% adalah 5510 kat sini. Okay, so bila 12% 1445 lebih kurang. Okay, bila interest kita kosong, NPV kosong, kita punya interest adalah 18.4 kat sini lebih kurang. So NPV negatif 806, interest kita adalah 22% lebih kurang. Okay, sama juga dengan existing product, you plot dalam graph paper. Alright, so apa yang kita nak cari kat sini adalah intersection dia. Okay, maksudnya yang bersilang tu. Okay. Alright, yang bersilang tu adalah titik pertemuan dia. Kat situlah kita akan determine berapa interest yang sepatutnya kita go for. Okay, 15.5%. Okay, so itulah result sebenar untuk kedua-dua projek A and B ni tadi. Okay, so dia punya rule of thumb untuk incremental analysis adalah, sorry. Okay, itu untuk graph paper eh. Nanti later on bila saya dah tunjuk formula ni, saya akan tunjuk macam ni nak pilih. Okay, go for new product atau existing product. Okay, ini untuk graph paper, macam ni nak plot. Okay, nanti after this session, maybe you boleh try to plot your own lah. Okay, or maybe after this, ni saya tunjuk secara teori. Later on, nanti you boleh apply using your calculator, try calculate sendiri. The calculation yang based on this table lah. Okay, ini gunakan formula. Alright. So, ini kita dah calculate tadi. New product, existing product. Okay, kita dah calculate tadi NPV. Ini total bila 0 interest 5510, 3611. IRR tadi kita dah calculate 18.4 dengan 20.2. Okay. So first, dekat kolom ni, okay, you kena tolak A minus B. Okay, negatif 900, tolak negatif 900, you akan dapat kosong. Okay, 480, tolak 5800, you akan dapat 5320. Okay, yang ni you tolak, dua ni. Okay, ni tolak ni. Okay, you akan dapat ni. Okay, yang ni you tolak. You tolak, minus. Right, so you akan dapat jawapan di kolom A minus B ni. Okay. So, PW factor 12%, you can get from the table. Okay, PDF tadi, yang saya tunjuk tadi. Alright. So, here, what you need to do is that this column A minus B ni, dengan kolom PW 12% ni, you need to times it. Okay, kena darab. Okay, kena darab. Negatif 5320 times 0.893, you akan dapat this one. 4751. Right, yang ini you times 450 times 0.797, you akan dapat 359. Okay, yang ini you times ni, you akan dapat 3240. And then you akan dapat this one. Okay, and then after that, untuk PW 22%, okay, yang ni pun you akan dapat daripada table PDF tadi, gunakan kolom yang sama ni, A minus B ni, okay, you times ni pula. Jadi maksudnya negatif 5320 darab 0.820. 450 darab 0.67. Dua. Okay, yang then you akan dapat di semua. Okay, so after that, you need to total up this section. Okay, tambahkan dia. Kosong, tambah 47, negatif 4751. Then tambah ni, then tambah ni, then tambah ni, you akan dapat 259. Okay, so yang ini pun sama, you akan tambah ni, tambah ni, tambah ni, tambah ni, you akan dapat negatif 552. Okay, so bila tu, you akan apply formula yang IR tadi. Okay, okay, you apply formula IR tadi. This one is yang interest yang rendah, 12, 12 dengan 22 is 12. Okay, 259, 22 tolak 12, 259 tolak negatif 552, dia akan dapat 15.2%. Okay, so here how you decide, okay, fissure intersection dia adalah at 15.2. Kalau graph paper tadi lebih kurang dia dapat 15.2. Okay, jawapan dia akan lebih kurang sama. Saya tadi 15.5 sebab I'm not using graph paper. Okay, tak dapat yang accurate punya. Maybe when you apply in graph paper, you akan dapat more roughly the same lah, like using the formula. Okay, so if the MRR, MARR is more than 15.2%, you need to choose product A, which is new product. If the MARR is less than 15.2%, you need to go for product B, means that existing product. So apa dia MARR ni tadi? Okay, MARR ni tadi. Okay, you go balik pada soalan asal tadi. Mana soalan tadi? Okay, soalan asal tadi, this is MARR. Minimum acceptable rate of return is 12%. Okay, 12% eh. So sekarang ni you dapat 15.2. Okay, 12% ni kurang ke lebih daripada 15.2? Anyone?
Kurang.
Okay, kurang. So kurang maksudnya dalam kes ni kita kena pilih produk B. Alright, kalau AMARR you adalah 16%, you kena pilih produk B. Produk A. Okay, so you kena based off MARR yang diberikan dalam soalan. Kalau yang tadi diberikan adalah 12%. Yang ini, so based on this calculation, we go for product B. Sebab dia less than 15.2%. Okay. So that's how you apply what we call it as NPV, IRR, and also kalau ada conflict, kita apply incremental analysis. Okay. I know it's quite tough for you to get a great picture when you learn about calculation ni lah dalam bentuk macam ni. Okay, however, I already try my best to give the understanding to you. After this, it's up to you to get a more understanding by trying to maybe based on the notes today, you boleh try calculate your own to get a better understanding before kita buat exercise bersama-sama later on. Okay, so last part untuk hari ni. Okay, I know it's already much, too much for you. Okay, sebab banyak nak kena calculate, nak kena apply the formula, nak kena ambil sini, calculate sini dan sebagainya. Okay, the last one is what we call it as a modified internal rate of return. Alright, MRR is a return earned by the project as if the cash flow from the project are reinvested at the company's discount rate. So the purpose of MRR are the first one to help to overcome the disadvantage of IRR when IRR and NPV produce a contradictory ranking but for mutually exclusive project. Okay, so means that bila kita apply this MIRR, kita akan selesaikan masalah conflict tadi. Okay, and then the purpose of MIRR also to avoid the problems of multiple IRRs. It means that tadi saya cakap bila kita nak apply IRR, kita kena implement konsep trial and error. Okay, kalau you tengok table yang saya bagi tu, persen tu ada banyak. Ada 15, 16, 18, 20, 22. You nak try satu-satu. It's time consuming. But when you apply this MIRR, that can solve that problem. That can selesaikan masalah tu. Okay, so MIRR ni is more accurate than IRR. Okay, because the basically this MIRR will measure the true rate of return lah. Okay, the accuracy is more higher compared to IRR and also NPV. Okay. Okay. Alright. When you want to apply MIRR, kita akan gunakan formula last two weeks yang kita belajar time value of money, yang first formula tu. Apa nama tu? Kita ada 6. Yang mula-mula kita belajar apa? Compound amount tak silap saya. Okay. Compound amount. Kita akan gunakan formula ni. S, P tambah 1, punca kuasa N. Okay. So, kenapa kita guna formula ni? Sebab kita nak predict future value, okay, of our investment. Okay. Contoh kat sini. So, rate yang dia bagi adalah 12%. Kita masih gunakan soalan yang sama tadi, example yang sama. Okay, masih scenario yang sama. Cuma kaedah dia kita guna, method kita berbeza. Sekarang kita gunakan MIRR. Okay, so modal yang sama RM9,000 yang diberikan. So, yang ini kita tak perlu calculate. Okay, yang sekarang kita adalah, concern adalah cash flow yang diberikan. 480, 370, 6550, 3780. Okay. So, kita gunakan formula ni, kita tahu sekarang provisional sum kita adalah 480. Itu nilai kita sekarang. Kita nak tahu in future 480 ni berapa value dia. So that's why kita kena apply formula compound amount ni tadi, S equals to P ni tadi. Okay, kita dah tahu P value dia. P value dia, provisional sum dia adalah 480. Okay, apa yang kita tak tahu sekarang adalah S ni. Okay, future value dia. Okay. So formula dia 1 tambah I, interest dia adalah 0.12, 12%. And dia, kenapa 3? Sebab ini tahun pertama. Projek ni 4 tahun. Okay, so maksudnya kita ada 3 tahun lagi untuk sampai ke tahun keempat ni. There will be another 3 years untuk kita tahu future value kita 480 ni selepas 3 tahun. Okay, so kita ada 3 tahun lagi kat sini, as you can see in this table. Okay, so sebab tu kita letak 3 kat sini. Alright, so you apply this formula, you akan dapat 6774. Eh, sama juga dengan produk B ni tadi atau existing produk tadi. Apply the same concept, you akan dapat 8146. Okay, untuk tahun kedua, cash flow kita target 3,700. Okay, 3,700. Okay, sama. Cuma yang membezakan adalah end value dia. Sebab apa? Tahun kedua ni, kita ada lagi 2 tahun nak sampai tahun keempat. Okay, so kita kena predict selepas 2 tahun, berapa value 3,700 after 2 years. Okay, that's why our end value is 2. Okay, ada lagi nak join? Okay, so that's why we are using 2. Okay, the end value is 2. So you get 4641.3. Okay, same process, 4076.8. Alright. And then the third year, okay, the third year, okay, cash flow kita 6550. Okay, kita masukkan dalam formula, end value kita akan jadi 1 sebab kita ada setahun saja untuk sampai tahun keempat. Okay, so kita apply, kita dapat 7336. So kat sini untuk existing product kita dapat 2240. Okay, untuk tahun keempat, cash flow kita 3780. Kita masukkan dalam formula, end value kita 0. Sebab apa 0? Sebab kita dah berada di tahun keempat. Okay, kita dah tak perlu, tak ada, there is no future value for this amount sebab cash flow kita sampai 4 tahun keempat saja. So tak perlu kira. Tapi still kena masukkan dalam formula. So bila you apply the formula, you still dapat 3780. Kat sini pun you still dapat 1561. Sama. Alright. So next, after that, what you need to do is that you need to total up this four amount. Okay, you need to add up all this amount. Okay, so same goes to here. Kita tambah ke empat-empat ni, you need to add up all this four amount. Alright, then you will get the total value, what we call it as a terminal value of product A and terminal value for existing product, okay, product B. Alright, and then you apply, masukkan dalam formula untuk produk A, formula yang sama. Okay. So sekarang ni kita nak cari I, because we know the sum value. S kita dah tahu, 16,431.70. P kita dah tahu, this is kita punya modal, 9,001. Tahun kita dah tahu, 4 years. Alright, apa yang kita nak cari adalah I value ni. Okay, interest rate. So you apply the formula, you will get 16.24%. So product B, you apply the formula, you will get 15.4%. Okay, so dalam, based on this calculation, we go for higher percentage lah. Alright, so dalam case ni, kita akan pilih produk A lah sebab percentage dia lebih tinggi, 16.24%. Okay, so this is how you apply MIRR for calculating the best option, evaluating the best option for your companies, whether you want to go for new product or whether you want to go for existing product. Okay, so this is one, this one is using MIRR. Okay, that's all for today. Any question? Ada soalan?
Formula biasa memang ada bagi, rasa.
Formula yang mana tu? Formula yang table-table tadi memang tak ada bagi. Jadi you kena practice. Mana nak ambil, mana nak ambil. Apa yang dibagi dalam exam biasanya adalah table ni. Okay, table, formula yang kita belajar on lecture 7, that one will be given. That's it, formula. Yang tu biasanya diberi dalam exam.
Okay.
So yang table tadi nak kena hafal ke? Oh, itu gila kalau hafal tu. Alright, that table will be provided. Don't worry. Okay, the table will be provided. Okay.
Untuk every project, memang kena apply daripada NPV sampai ke MIRR eh? Kalau ada 5 formula yang kita, lagi 2 kita belum belajar tu, memang dia kena apply sampai habis kan, doktor?
That's why I mentioned just now, it's not necessary to apply all. It's not necessary. And it's also not advisable to apply only one method. Okay? Tapi it's good kalau company tu boleh apply semua. Bagus. Sebab bila kita apply semua, kita akan lebih nampak yang mana lebih terbaik. Kita ada strong support. Okay. Tapi minimum at least kalau dapat 2 tadi cukup lah. Itu pun dah cukup. NPV dengan IRR. Okay, itu pun dah cukup.
Kira some project kalau nak lebih accurate, lebih daripada 2 pun tak apalah gitu.
Yes. Dapat yang lebih accurate. Kita punya result yang lebih accurate, is better to go for more than 2. Okay, if possible, gunalah kelima-lima method yang kita akan belajar.
Okay, thank you doktor.
Okay, tak faham part Fisher intersection, more than or less 2. Sekejap, saya buka balik slide. Yang mana tadi? Ini. Okay, this one kan? Okay, saya...
Yes, sir.
Alright, I repeat again. Okay, based on this fissure intersection yang kita calculate guna formula dan guna table ni tadi, guna graph ni tadi, kita dapat 15.5 dengan 15.2. Okay, kalau you guna graph pun lebih kurang lah, you dapat 15.2 lah. Let's say kita ambil 15.2. Okay, so dia punya rule of thumb nak pilih yang mana. Kalau MARR lebih daripada 15.2, you pilih project product A. Kalau MARR less than 15.2, you go for product B. Okay, so dalam case kita, example yang kita buat sekarang, MARR kita adalah 12% ni tadi. Okay, 12%. Sebab soalan diberikan tadi adalah 12%. Okay, 12%. Minimum acceptable rate of return. Ni dipanggil MARR. Okay, so 12%. So 12% tu value dia kurang daripada 15. Okay, sebab tu kita kena go for product B. Okay, so kita tak boleh go for product A sebab MRR kita tak tak melebihi 15.2. Okay, tapi kalau MARR kita adalah 18 katakan. Okay, so 18% kita punya MARR, not 12%, is 18%, kalau 18%. So kita kena go for product A lah sebab dia lebih besar daripada 15.2. Okay, so that's the scenario. Boleh, Izzah?
So kalau macam let's say kita tulis MARR more than 15.2%, choose product B tak boleh lah?
Tak boleh.
Okay. Dia memang, susun dia memang macam tu.
Yes, susunan dia memang macam ni.
Okay, alright, faham.
Susunan dia memang macam ni.
Okay, thank you, Doktor.
Okay. So saya panggil, saya cakap tadi the rule of thumb.
So, kalau ada tiga produk macam mana, sir?
Kalau ada tiga produk, you boleh awal-awal lagi you dah boleh eliminate yang yang terendah.
Okay.
Okay, sebab bila you apply, let's say you apply MPB dulu, MPB kan dia akan keluar result yang berbeza kan? Alright, so dari situ you boleh rank. Mana yang rank, yang mana yang tertinggi, kedua tinggi, ketiga tinggi. Okay, yang ketiga tu you boleh reject awal-awal lah.
Okay. Alright, thank you, Doktor.
Alright. Aris, baru je jawab. Okay, Aris. Alright, kalau you tengok dalam you future tu ada, saya dah masukkan slide untuk atau PDF file untuk exercise tu. Okay, so perhaps tak perlu tunggu saya suruh, maybe you boleh take your own initiative, try buat dulu. Play around mana yang kita dah belajar, I think ni exercise tu you all yang saya dah upload dalam Island. Okay, perhaps soalan satu ni you dah boleh try buat dulu. Soalan dua pun you dah boleh try buat dulu. Soalan tiga pun you dah boleh try buat dulu. Okay, soalan empat pun dah boleh try buat dulu. Lima dengan enam je kita akan belajar esok. Satu, dua, tiga, empat ni sebenarnya dah boleh buat dah. You boleh try. Try lah. Buat dulu. Kalau you tak try, you tak nampak you punya pemahaman. Saya tak boleh nak check you punya pemahaman sebab we are in this kind of situation. It's very difficult for me to monitor lah. But hopefully if you don't understand, please ask. Okay, boleh tanya. I try my best to give a better understanding for you lah. Okay, ada apa-apa lagi nak tanya?
Rasanya tak ada, sir.
Tak ada, sir. Tak ada, sir.
Okay, kalau tak ada, I think we can end up our session. But before that, Okay, before that, tomorrow we will continue with lecture 9. Okay, kita ada dua lagi method yang kita belajar tadi, payback period and also accounting rate of return, ARR. Okay, so kita akan cover that two tomorrow. Saya akan habiskan dua tu tomorrow. And then after that, you need to do try your own to complete that exercise two. Next week on Wednesday, we are going to discuss it. Okay, saya akan sediakan skema jawapan untuk kita sama-sama tengok. Tapi hopefully you try dululah. Okay, you try buat dulu, sebab kalau you tak try buat dulu, you bergantung pada saya punya jawapan, perhaps nanti lagi susah you nak faham. So kalau you try buat walaupun tak dapat, salah ke apa ke tak apa. Okay, from there you boleh identify where your mistake. Okay, kalau you tak try, perhaps you tak boleh nampak nanti. Tak boleh nampak jalan dia. Okay, so hopefully you boleh try dulu buat. And then we are going to discuss all the answers for exercise 2 next week on Wednesday. And then before that, are there any repeaters today? Ada tak repeaters dalam session sekarang? Eh?
Ada.
Ada, sir.
Ada? Okay, Adi Iqbal ada. Alright, so I'm planning to have to conduct your paper 1 punya exam in week ni 8 9 in week 10 on Wednesday. Saya tak kisah dengan yang full timers, yang first timers ni. Yang saya risau ni sekarang repeaters. Okay, takut clash dengan subjek lain. Okay, boleh tak you commit untuk buat that paper 1 on week 10 Wednesday 4 to 6 PM, session macam session hari ni lah.
Ya boleh, sir.
Yang lain?
Boleh, sir.
Peter, I think ada few yang seorang tu ada, I think site ke siapa tak nama dia, dia tak masuk ke ni. Never mind, nanti saya akan tanya lagi. I think ada few repeaters yang tak boleh join session hari ini. Saya akan tanya lagi dalam group untuk make sure you boleh, all the repeaters can attend that session lah for exam. Okay, how are we going to do it? Okay, that exam, like you do it for your tutorial, okay, assignment. Okay, kita akan gunakan you future. Okay, okay, you future, saya masih share. Yeah, saya dah stop session. Okay, saya masih share, alright. Alright, sama juga continuous assessment, you pergi kepada assignment. Dah ada standby dah kat sini, paper 1. Akan start pukul 4, maksudnya next week, not next week. Week 10 tadi, masa hari Rabu, pukul 4 tu you dah boleh start assess. Okay, you boleh buka dalam ni, boleh download soalan, boleh tengok soalan dia, you jawab dalam masa 2 jam 15 minit saya bagi. Okay, dua soalan, jawab dua-dua, tak ada pilihan. Okay, dua soalan, yeah. Jawab dua-dua. Okay, soalan dia semua berkisar pada teori, yang calculation yang kita belajar daripada start week 7 tak masuk, eh. Focus on teori saja. Lecture 1 sampai lecture 6. Okay, so focus that one saja. Ada dua soalan compulsory for you to answer both, tak ada pilihan. Okay, you boleh answer directly dalam you future ni. Okay, you boleh jawab terus dalam tu, type terus dalam tu. Saya tak nak jawab dalam tu. You kena handwriting, jawab dalam kertas, and then you kena scan or ambil gambar, upload dalam you future as well. Dalam masa 2 jam 15 minit, I think should be enough. Okay, sebab nak jawab soalan essay ni, kalau dalam normal exam pun biasanya 40 minit, dua soalan 90 minit, sejam setengah sahaja you perlukan untuk jawab soalan essay. Okay, untuk soalan exam ni biasanya sejam setengah is the maximum for you, 90 minutes. Tapi saya bagi you extra 2 jam 15 minit, lebih 45 minit. Okay, untuk saya bagi consideration untuk you snap gambar, untuk upload, okay, dalam you future. So hopefully manage time properly, jangan terlebih masa. Okay, tolong upload dalam masa yang ditetapkan ni, 2 jam 15 minit. Okay, so please manage your time properly. Okay, buka, dah dapat soalan, terus dijawab dalam paper, siap, ambil gambar, upload terus. Okay, so pada yang bermasalah dengan internet dan sebagainya, carilah tempat yang yang ada line yang agak kuat. Okay, soalan bukan objektif, soalan subjektif. Esei. Okay. Boleh? Nanti next, okay, nanti next week saya akan remind balik. So, next week on Thursday saya tak buat kelas. I give you time for you to start your revision. So, I think starting from today, you dah boleh start lah. Do your revision focusing on lecture 1 sampai lecture 6. Kalau you future tu yang prop, sir. Alright, hopefully tak ada problem. Okay, hopefully tak ada problem. In case kalau ada masalah, maybe problem, in case lah, hopefully kita doa-doa tak ada masalah lah in future tu on that day. Kalau bermasalah on that day, cepat-cepat let me know, you boleh submit dekat saya directly. Okay, saya tak nak terima directly WhatsApp daripada you sebab kalau you all ada 99 orang WhatsApp kepada saya agak tak practical lah. So that's why kita ada platform you feature, you boleh upload dalam tu terus and then saya boleh check kat situ terus. Okay, kalau bermasalah itu saya terima lah. Okay, so hopefully tak ada masalah lah untuk for you untuk upload dalam you feature. Okay?
Okay.
So, that's all for today. Okay, try to do the exercise yang mana boleh buat, buat dulu. Okay, cuba buat. Kalau tak buat, you tak boleh nampak nanti. Alright, sebab untuk topik ni ada test ya. Saya nak remind awal-awal ada test. Okay, so kalau you tak practice nanti, maybe susah untuk you do test nanti. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you for your time. I will share this recorded version later on. Macam biasalah, nanti saya dah upload dari YouTube. Saya akan share the link later on for you lah. Okay. So, thank you for your time and commitment. Okay. See you tomorrow. Don't forget, kita masih ada lecture 9 tomorrow untuk continue lagi 2 methods. Alright, so that's all for today. Take care. Assalamualaikum and...
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.